do mutual funds really deserve the kind of importance that they do?
I think they completely do, right? So India's got a patchy history. We've had public sector funds where a lot of people didn't have great experience in the 80s and especially in the 90s. But I think in the last 20 years, since a lot of the private sector mutual funds have come, I think the track record and numbers speak for themselves. So if you've, you know, some of you remember seeing some chart over a 20, 25 year period, a lot of these funds have given 20% to 25% annualized returns. And of course, the markets in India have done well, but they've given almost a 10 to 15% per annum return over and above the markets. So they've done an exceptional job. I think, you know, we're also, you know, we run a large retail brokerage operation, and I see a lot of individual investors who essentially trade over 2, 3, 4, 5 years and don't end up making money. And a lot of people end up losing money because, you know, they're working on the basis of limited information. And I think if you see the example in the West, you know, institutional investing is the best way to go forward. If somebody takes 1.5% but is actually able to deliver results, I think it's a great way to sort of participate in the equity markets. In our view, that's the preferred route to participate in the equity markets.
Amit, is this an India-specific story, or are mutual funds a preferred route even in developed markets like the US for that?
In fact, in the developed markets, your retirement monies also have to go through mutual funds. So they have something called the 401k plans. In the UK, they have IRAs.
Yeah.
And that money is not given to some government body like the, you know, EPFO or whatever to manage money and put in government bonds. You can actually pick your own mutual funds. So there you would see mutual fund, you know, penetration as a percentage of GDP is 40%, 50%, 60%. In India, it's 3 or 4%. So mutual funds are clearly an established mechanism. They are well regulated, and in fact, costs are low. The regulators have kept on bringing the costs down. I think there is no better way right now. You know, and globally, we have a roadmap, and these countries have had funds for 50 years, 60 years, 70 years. So I think it's a much better
We've got 400, if not more, mutual funds to choose from. Let's start by telling us, how do you go about choosing this? Do you go with the most famous fund house? Do you go with something your neighbor is invested in? Do you go with the most popular, highest return in the previous year fund? I mean, there are so many parameters that one uses. As retail investors, I know that process is far more cumbersome because you don't have access to information as much as, or advice, actually, not even information. So help us understand, with so much available in the market and so much changing so often and frequently, what are the sort of parameters one needs to look at to start this investment process?
I think it's like, you know, there is therefore this layer between an investor and a mutual fund. There's a role for an advisor. It's likewise, you know, it's like having a doctor between a patient and a chemist. You know, most of us end up in India, we're so used to going to chemist directly and doing OTC medication ourselves. But in most cases, when you have a long-term chronic situation, it's best to use a healthcare sort of professional or doctor in between, who has the ability to oversee, you know, see the entire situation and advise. Now, how do you pick mutual funds? There is a lot of, you know, sort of effort, science, statistics, knowing people who are involved in the fund management. And that's where, you know, really today we have about 40 people dedicated just doing that on a full-time basis.
Yeah.
And it's difficult to sort of sum it up in 2 minutes. But what I can say is the biggest mistake all of us make when we pick mutual funds is by looking at their past returns. It's like driving, looking in the rearview mirror, ki past mein kya hua. And I think one of the big exercises that at least what we try and do is predict who are the fund houses, fund managers who are likely to do better over a 5-10 year period, meet the investment objectives that we have set out for them, who have consistency. And I can share one thing, you know, that Feroz and his team have done exceptionally well. Something very simple. What does a fund manager do? Take decisions, buying and selling. One of the simplest way any investor can evaluate a mutual fund is look at how many decisions have they got right and how many decisions have they got wrong. It's something called, you know, we call a right to wrong ratio. So if today I have a fund manager who has taken 100 decisions in the last 5 years and he has taken 60% right decisions, okay, I have that number, maybe he's delivered a 15% per annum return. On the other hand, I have a fund manager who's taken 45% right decisions, but he's actually delivered a better return than the first fund manager. Now it's very simple. If I'm trying to look for consistency, right, I want a Rahul Dravid or a Sachin Tendulkar, not a Virendra Sehwag. You know, it's just drawing an analogy that somebody's got a more consistent performance is what. So this is one example of something that we would look at. And of course, you know, it boils down to, again, like, why do we go to mutual fund managers? One of the big reasons we go to mutual fund managers is because they research companies and not just doing paper research. right? Would you put money with a fund manager who only says I pick stocks, reading newspaper articles, online, you know, articles, reading magazines? You won't.
Or follow chats.
Or follow chats or chat groups, WhatsApp groups, and WhatsApp groups have become very, very popular. You know, the best fund managers have their ears on the ground. They're talking to companies, yeah, suppliers, distributors, company, you know, competition, private companies, and they build a 360 degree view. And so one at one level, while we look at all these numbers, we also talk to the entire teams of these fund management teams. And then you sort of, you know, combine and build a 360 degree view. It's not to say we can't go wrong, but really what you're trying to do is build a combination of 6, 7, 8
names.
And if your objective is clear, then it's not too difficult to build those 6, 7, 8 names.